And I want to talk this morning for just a little while before our general superintendent comes on this subject, something to die for. Something to die for. You may be seated. We have a little catchphrase among the young people in America right now that I don't quite understand. And they say, it's to die for. I don't know if you have that here or not. But for example, if you see a beautiful chocolate cake and your mouth begins to water, you might say, ooh, that's to die for. Of course, when you eat enough of it, you will die. Or if a young lady sees a beautiful purse, she goes, oh, that's to die for. Or a new pair of shoes, that's to die. That's not to die for. But I want to talk about something this morning that is to die for. Amen. Except the corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. Hallelujah. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. I'd like to turn our attention to a scripture in the book of Esther for just a few moments as I begin here. Esther chapter number 4, verses 15 and 16. Then Esther bade them return Mordecai this answer. Go. Gather together all the Jews that are present in Shushan, and fast ye for me, neither eat nor drink 3 days, night or day. I also and my maidens will fast likewise, and so will I go unto the king, which is not according to the law. And if I perish, I perish. If I perish, I perish. There is something happening in our world that's worth dying for. This is what Esther was saying. Let's give you just a little bit of history. King Xerxes, or better known as Ahasuerus, had chosen Esther from all the young women of the kingdom to become his new queen. Ooh, don't you love romance? But danger lies ahead. Let me just give you a little bit of history. Something that we discovered that I hadn't really noticed before. We talk about the greatness of Mordecai, and truly he was a great man for what he stood for. However, if you will turn back in your Bible, we won't take time to read the scriptures, but if you turn back into 2 Chronicles chapter number 36, as well as Ezra 1, and you read these chapters, you will discover that God had commanded or had instructed all of the Jewish people to return to their homeland to rebuild his temple. How many does all include? All is everyone. 2 Chronicles 36, Ezra chapter 1, had commanded all the Jews that were around the world to return to their homeland. That included Jews that were in Persia, where Mordecai lived. Hello. They had not obeyed the instructions from the Lord. I've got to just stop here a moment and let this sink in. Sometimes we think when we don't obey, we get by with something. It's not getting into us. Sometimes we think if we don't follow the instructions and nothing happens immediately, that everything is okay. But it's not okay. The Jewish people that had been instructed to return to their homeland, but they were so comfortable where they were in Persia that they said, we'll just stay here. What if God called you to go to some place, but you're so comfortable where you're at, you decide, I won't go. Now we read it from the other side of the story, and I like it when they finally take a stand. But in this scenario, Mordecai even instructed his family to keep their identity hid. If you're not willing to be a Christian and stand up as a Christian, what's going to happen? You know, history is such a terrible thing to look at because it gives you the facts. And if we don't pay attention to the facts of history, we repeat them, the negative parts of them. So here we have a Jewish queen in a foreign land that shouldn't have been there to start with. If they had just obeyed the Lord. Oh, some of the problems we get ourselves into. If we had just obeyed the Lord, we wouldn't have been in the problems. Oh, hallelujah. Well, at least I can throw it out there and you can study a little bit and chew on it. Amen. Now, one day when Mordecai was at the palace gate, he overheard two of the king's officers plotting to kill the king. So he sent the report to Esther. And he said, Esther, I think we're going to have to finally stand up for who we are. A little more history, okay? Can I give you just a little more history on the story? In the book of 1 Samuel, chapter number 1, verses 1 to 35, you can read the story. We won't take the time. But God commanded Israel to completely destroy the Amalekites. Amen? You know that story and how they saved the king alive. And then we always preach about the man that killed Saul was an Amalekite. He said, I am an Amalekite. But if you read the genealogy of the Amalekites, you know, you read down through that genealogy and you know what you discover? Haman was from the Amalekites. Haman, wicked Haman, who hated the Jewish nation, should have never been there to start with if Israel had obeyed the commandment of the Lord. Oh, I tell you, I feel the Holy Ghost talking to me. There might be some things I don't understand about the commandments of the Lord or even what the executive board says. You know, sometimes they say, is it from the Lord or the board? We hope those things are in alignment, the Lord and the board. And if they make a command, we might not understand it, but lo and behold, if we don't obey the command, down the road, we'll face the consequences. First of all, the Jews should not have been there to begin with if they had obeyed the command. Second of all, Haman would not have been there if they had obeyed the commandments of the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. you. This is not usually the way I preach about Esther. I'm so happy about Esther. But when I read the history of it all and I put it all together, I find out what happened was a consequence of disobedience. So from Agag's family line comes Haman, a consequence of past sin. Haman was a great enemy of the Jewish people. They wouldn't have been in that situation if they'd just obeyed from the beginning. Why is it so difficult to obey God? It's always best to obey. It's always best to obey. Now we're familiar with Haman's furious anger to kill all of the Jews in King Ahasuerus' kingdom. We know that. And the day had been declared when their lives would come to an end. So there's a challenge. There's a challenge. And I'll just tell you this morning, my purpose and my message is to throw out a challenge. Better get this clock out. Because that's the challenge. That's the challenge to get finished and leave something for Brother Bodegas to say. Esther has a choice. Do I accept the challenge? Or do I go on with my comfortable life? She accepted the challenge. And I think today there are people that are sitting right here, and those some that are not here, that are willing to accept a challenge. If I perish, I'll just have to perish. But there's something worth dying for. Something worth dying for. Hallelujah. As a young minister, well, young missionary, I started off young, not as young as Brother David Flowers. Oh, no wonder he's my elder. He was preaching when I was in diapers almost. Not really, but close. Oh, but I was a young man. I pastored. I was involved in district work at my level. When I became a missionary, when I was the ripe old age of 30. And I remember soon after I came to the Philippines, I was in a conference, and our beloved Brother Romy Navallo was up preaching in a conference. And in that message, he made this statement or something very similar to it. I'll never forget it, and I don't ever want to forget it. He said, for the sake of the gospel, if we really want to see revival in the Philippines, we must be willing to water the soil with our very blood. And that's my introduction to the Philippines, that we have people here that are willing to give their life for the gospel in this nation and around the world. Hallelujah. Something to die for. And that came from the mouth of one of your ministers. The only life worth living is the life you lose. That's the only life worth living. Mark chapter 8, verse 35. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. So I'm going to come back to a challenge. We have a challenge in the Philippines. And don't forget it. I have a challenge as the regional director for all of the Pacific. And I've just got to tell you what that is. Okay? I've just got to tell you what it is. We have a vision and a goal to reach every inhabited island with the apostolic message through laboring together in apostolic ministry. I heard Brother Amado Perez talking up here yesterday. He said, we already have plans in Region 2. We're going to go to the next island. We're going to set up a new district in that island. Then we're going to the next island. We're going to set up a district in that island. What's happening? We're getting a vision to reach every inhabited island. And we've got to do it for the sake of the gospel. What is true salvation? True salvation is repentance of our sins. Baptism in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of our sins, and the infilling of the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the initial evidence of speaking with other tongues and living a life separated from the world unto God. That's the gospel. Hallelujah. We've got islands to reach. We've got barangays to reach. We've got towns to reach. We've got cities to reach. That's our mandate. We've got to do it. That's the challenge. And I'll just be honest with you, and I think I have. Why do I say that? I should always be honest with you. When I first received this responsibility as the regional director, I opened a map and I looked at that great big Pacific Ocean. There's a lot of water. Too big.
Too big.
And every now and then there's a little island. And then a lot more water. And another little island. And I begin to ask God to help us. And I begin to come together with something. That we need to connect the dots. Each of those tiny dots out in the ocean. They need to be connected. And as the regional director, I'm seeing it happen. Fiji has now sent a regional missionary to Kiribati. Hallelujah. 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 For connecting dots out in the ocean. Because we've got to reach every inhabited island. We've got to do it. It's what God has asked us all to do. Hallelujah. It needs to be ingrained within us. I believe every Bible school should teach to reach your neighbors. It's not just Bible knowledge, but it's also Bible challenge. It's also challenge from the Bible. Amen. On May 25, 1961, John F. Kennedy, then the President of the United States, stood before a joint session of Congress at a critical juncture in the space race. The Soviet Union had launched Sputnik into Earth's orbit just a few years prior to that. They had a head start. They had a head start on the space race, if you could say it like that. But he stood before the joint session of Congress and he boldly made this statement. I believe that this United States of America should commit itself into achieving a goal. That before this decade is out, within 10 years, we need to land a man on the moon. And then bring him back to Earth safely. It was a bold challenge. But just 8 years, and 2 months later, Neil Armstrong took one small step for mankind and one small step, but a giant leap for mankind. And they finished. That's because somebody accepted a challenge. Because somebody accepted a challenge. I'm talking about this because I want you today to accept a challenge. That's what I want. I'll just tell you up front. I'm not going to sneak up on you. I'm just going to tell you, I want you to accept the challenge. Bold dreams have to be backed up by bold actions. Hallelujah. It starts by focusing our eyes on the harvest. It starts by making a bold vision, setting a clear purpose, and then backing it up with our resources, our finances, and our men. It's like Martin Luther in October 31, 1517. We have a new baptistry. Salama. October 31, 1517. He walked to the door of that Wittenberg castle and he posted 95 reasons why things had to change. August 28, 1963, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. delivered a speech, "I Have a Dream," at the Lincoln Memorial in the United States of America. And it's like this regional director saying, "I have a vision. We will reach. We will reach these islands." Nehemiah received some devastating news. The walls are broken down. The gates are destroyed. "My beloved Jerusalem is in decay." The words were absorbed in his very soul. He begins to pray. He begins to weep. He begins to mourn over the city that is in ruin. "What am I doing to reach my barangay? What am I doing to reach my neighbors? To reach my family?" This passion consumed Nehemiah. So he was willing to take up a challenge. Hallelujah. It began. He was in anguish because God's special people were unprotected. There's nothing easy or comfortable about doing what God called Nehemiah to do. He was not willing to let things stay status quo. Hello. You know, I've been blessed to be a part of this Philippine church for many, many years now. You're better off than you've ever been. Hello. We have more than we've ever had. I'm not saying that's wrong. I'm happy. I want you to have more and more and more and more. However, I do not want to be lulled into the slumber state where I lose my vision and my passion. Amen. As a sign that Nehemiah was up to accept the challenge, even though he was surrounded by opponents on every side, there was people that mocked him, that ridiculed him, he chose that "I will accept this challenge." He cast the vision, recruited hundreds. I tried to get a little research done on this, and I found out that 8 years after the wall was completed, they completed that wall in 52 days. 8 years after it was completed, the population of Jerusalem was 4,200 people. I don't think it was 4,200 when he started building. Maybe 2,600, something like that. I'm just guessing, just throwing it out. Something to think about, but he unified that army to build the walls. Now, what makes this significant to me is when I look at the records of the United Pentecostal Church of the Philippines, how many ministers do we presently have? Brother Bodegas, do you know, I didn't write it down. How many ministers do we have now in the Philippines? more than 2,500 ministers in the Philippines. Nehemiah had about 2,600. It's a guess, I don't know. 8 years after the walls were finished, they had 4,200. Maybe he only had half that. I don't know. 2,000. But something happened when he got them all together. Something happened when they all got a hold of the vision. Something happened when they grasped his vision and were willing to lay down their lives for it. Because that's exactly what they did. They put a trowel in one hand and they put a sword in the other hand. If the enemy comes, they can kill me, but I'm going to follow through on the vision. Hallelujah. And that group that he had was about the same number that we have as ministers in the Philippines today. Hallelujah. Doesn't that do something for us? We can do what Nehemiah did. We can do what Nehemiah did if we're willing to die for it. If we're willing to die for it. Hallelujah. Praise God. He had to throw down a challenge to those who lived in that city or lived around it. And then he took that massive job and broke it down into manageable sized pieces, just like we're doing with Omsafi. Hello? We don't expect one of you to win a million, but we expect one of you to win one. Hallelujah! I heard yesterday in the minister's meeting, there's a discussion about giving a reward to the person that wins the most souls. It's a nice thought, but I think we just all ought to do what we can do. If everybody will win one, that's manageable. Hallelujah. You put the right leaders in the right place at the right time and the right people to die for their vision, you're going to have an explosion take place. Amen. It's time to throw down the gauntlet. Has anybody ever heard that phrase? To throw down the gauntlet? I brought a gauntlet with me. Was a piece of armor that was worn by the knights. It's metal, got a leather glove that's encased in metal. It was used as a defensive weapon. Now, in our devotions this morning, Brother Casimero told us about the armor of God. He didn't tell us about this piece. It was added extra. It was used a whole lot for defensive purposes because most of their battles were hand to hand, sword to sword. So if they're swinging a sword at my hand, I want protection. And so you see, it comes down up over your arm just a little bit, and when they swing that sword, it hits the metal and then it protects you. But the gauntlet began to evolve into more of a decorative piece of armor. And then when a new king went to his coronation, the head knight would walk in front of the king. And just before the king would be coronated, that head knight would take his gauntlet and he would throw it down as a challenge. If anybody is not in agreement with this new king that's being crowned, come and pick up my gauntlet and we will fight to the death. Because I'm here to preserve this new king. So he threw down the gauntlet. Now most of the time, nobody picked it up. They don't want to fight him. But every now and then, somebody would walk over and pick up the gauntlet. And then the battle would take place between that man and the king's knight. And they would fight to the death. There's a power that wants to be enthroned in this world. And he is not the rightful king. Satan is the god of this world, sends his angels before him, and they're throwing a gauntlet down in front of you and me. They're saying, we're going to enthrone our king. But I believe there's somebody that is willing to say, that's not going to be my king. I'm going to take up the gauntlet, and I'm going to be willing to fight to the death for the true king. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, you know I used to live in Davao. What great experiences that's happened in my life. Has anybody here ever been to Tagupo Lupan, Davao Oriental? Tagupo Lupan? One? See, I'm Filipino. I went to Tagupo Lupan. They had a men's meeting, and they wanted me to come and teach that morning. So I had been gone from my home a lot, so I got up early in the morning, about 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, and drove 5 hours, almost 5 hours, at least back then, to Tagupo Lupan, Davao Oriental. And I taught. I taught for maybe an hour and a half, 2 hours. Don't worry. That was then. That was their schedule. So I have my clock right here, so I know what time it is. Okay. I taught. It was very nice. Went good. And it was around noon. We had lunch. You know, fish head soup and rice. Lami kayo. I had rice. And saging. Okay. And then I was getting ready to leave and drive back to Davao. Well, the wonderful presbyter or somebody there, not the presbyter, but the pastor or somebody said, oh, Sir Buckland, we would like for you to stay and preach here tonight because we're having a big rally. I said, oh, no, no, no. I'm going to be back with my family. I just committed to teach this morning, you know. They said, oh, sir, come here. We want to show you something. So I walk into the hall that they were renting there, and they had a big banner up with my name on it. Nakazabot. And then they pulled me aside, and they said, sir, you know, that village you came through to get here? I said, yeah. They said, they killed a man there yesterday. I said, I will stay. I will stay and preach tonight. So, it was great. I spent that afternoon getting ready. I did not preach in Cebuano yet. So Brother Romy Navaglio was translating for me. I remember what I preached that night. I was preaching, you gotta have faith. Kinahanglan kumintanan sa pagduo. And I'm preaching about faith, and here's Brother Romy translating for me. And so we're having a good time preaching. I start with Abraham and we're going through the Old Testament. And you stop every now and then. You gotta have faith, King. And so we're going through the message. And you know, this is out in the village. And there's one light, oil lamp, back there, hanging from the ceiling. And all of a sudden, the light goes out. Nyit, nyit, dio. You know, the Philippine face is brown. Nyit, nyit, dio. I can't see anything except some white. I heard them back there. They're shuffling. They're trying to crawl up the Nipah hut and get that light. And then somebody got down. And they finally get the light going and everybody's looking at me. And I'm looking at them and I said, you got to have faith. And so I get back into preaching and I'm going along and getting over there by David or somebody. And then all of a sudden I notice something. People start whispering back and forth. You know, Filipinos are always respectful. But it's amazing what you can see from up here. So they're whispering back and forth. And I don't know what to do. I look behind me and the preachers are whispering back and forth. I just stopped. Brother Alcantara was presbyter and I went to him and said, what's going on? He said, well, Brother Buckland, he said, while you've been preaching, he said, communist rebels, they've surrounded the building and they're pointing their guns in at us. He said, now you're our missionary, what should we do? I went to Bible school, but we didn't have that class. Finally, after a few moments, I told Brother O'Connor, I said, Luke, I said, I'll just keep preaching. I don't know what else, but I'll just keep preaching. He said, well, if you preach, we'll stay with you. I said, okay. So I got everybody's attention. They looked up. You got to have faith. He hammered, come into the hands of we start back into the message, and I got done real fast. It didn't take me much longer to finish. But while I'm preaching, the preachers that were, they stood up and they formed a line, and the preachers on the platform stood up and they walked up this side and they formed a human circle around me while I'm preaching. And you know, I don't stay in one place. So every time I move, they have to move. Brother Alcantara leans over to him and says, Brother Buckland, when they start shooting, we're going to do our best to keep you alive because you're our missionary. Something to die for. Something to die for. That's the Philippines, I know. Men that are willing to die, put their life on the line, to take up the gauntlet that said, I will never compromise. I will not King get on the throne. Hallelujah. And not long after that, I heard about Brother Seaman Gallows. Some of you know him. I forget the town he was in. Does anybody know? Bayugan. Pastor Seaman Gallows, great man of God. He was doing some things in his church, and there were some men that didn't like what he was doing. And so they sent him a threat. We will kill you by Sunday night. Well, he didn't know what to do, so he contacted his presbyter, Brother Victorino Alcantara. Brother Victorino Alcantara had small children at home, and one of them will be ordained here this evening. He had small children at home, had a lovely wife. I've been to their home many times. But when he got the message from Brother Gallows, he left his family, his young family and his wife. He went to Bayugan, and he stayed with him and fasted for 3 days, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Brother Gallows said, "Oh, you're my presbyter. I want you to preach on Sunday morning." And so he said, "Okay." He got up and preached Sunday morning. And then Brother Gallows said, "Oh, that was great. I want you to preach tonight." Because tonight's the night. These were not idle threats. Brother Alcantara looked at him and said, "You will preach tonight, Brother Gallows. But I will climb onto the platform and stand by your side. And if they kill you while you're preaching, I'll be your partner in death." Something to die for. Something to die for. Listen to me this morning. Something to die for. Except the corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it will never reproduce. And so the Lord is issuing a challenge to the Philippine church. Hallelujah. To give anything less than our best is to waste the gifting that God has given to us. Leonard Ravenhill made this statement: "We want big blessings for small investments. We want the birth of revival, but we don't want the pain of the birth." Before the reward, you must labor. You must plant before you harvest. You sow in tears before you reap in joy. Am I willing to take this gospel to neighboring barangays, to neighboring towns and villages, to neighboring islands? There's the gauntlet. It's thrown before us as a challenge. My former regional director, Brother Robert Rodenbusch, made this statement that I cannot escape. He said, "Since it is not granted us to live long on this earth, it is logical to give our best and most to something that will last eternally, reaching sinners and training saints." Is there someone here? A preacher? A saint? A young person? A man? A woman? Bible school students? Bible school graduates? One of the saddest things that happened to me when I was here, believe it or not, it did something to me. I was traveling in Mindanao, and we stopped and picked up a young man that was in the church, not really young anymore, but maybe in his 40s. He got in the car and we were talking, Brother Navajo, Brother Alcantara and I, and he said, "Yep." He said, "I'm part of the first batch." He said, "I was at the Bible school in Balibago before Brother Sean closed it down." He didn't close it down. We're just teasing him. He said, "I was in the first graduating class." I said, "Man, that's great." I said, "What are you doing now?" He said, "Oh, I work at the sawmill." Something hit me. "Why did you go to Bible school? Why did you go to Bible school to work at a sawmill? What's wrong? That's not why I've given my life to God." I've never forgotten those statements sitting in my car. It struck me that day. I almost began to cry, because such an investment is made into someone and they don't take up the gauntlet. When they don't take up the gauntlet. Oh, help us, Jesus. Let me tell you just a few little facts here about the Philippines. In 2017, the population of the Philippines is 103,796,000 souls. About 23 million of the people that live here are either full or partial Chinese. That's more than many nations. Just the Chinese population and ethnic descent that live in the Philippines. Almost 25%. Do we have Chinese evangelism? Oh, I know! We want to send Filipinos around the world to reach other Filipinos. What about the souls that God has put in our There's about 1,500,000 that are pure Chinese, right, in this nation. Your superintendent talked to me a couple of years ago. We need a missionary to come to the Philippines to reach the Chinese. But I believe there's somebody sitting here that would be willing to walk and say, I will not let that dragon sit on the throne. I will take up the gauntlet. There are 14 to 17 million ethnic tribal groups in the ethnic tribes in the Philippines. 14 to 17 million people. Most of them are in the mountains of Mindanao or in the mountains of northern Luzon. 14 to 17 million. There's a challenge before us. I said, there's a challenge before us. If somebody would be willing to take up the gauntlet and not allow the Rome King to be enthroned in this nation. How much do you love your own life? Through our living, and through our dying, others will be able to live eternally. When God blesses you financially, let's not be so selfish as to only raise our standard of living. When God blesses us financially, we need to raise our standard of giving. Raise my standard of living, but it's for the purpose to raise my standard of giving. That's why he blesses us. We have been given so much. Amen. Amen. One of you didn't say it. Amen?
Yeah.
Yeah. We have been given so much. But to whom much is given, much is required. Love for him at some point has to turn into giving, or it was never love to begin with. There's a writer, Anne Boscombe. She wrote these words, "The seed breaks to give us the wheat. The soil breaks to give us the crop. The sky breaks to give us the rain. The wheat breaks to give us the bread. The bread breaks to give us a feast. I remember one time there was even an alabaster box that was broken to give him glory. So don't be afraid to be broken. Ephesians 5:18, be filled with the Spirit. We cannot be filled with the Spirit if we're full of ourselves. Well, that sure went over good. I said, we cannot be filled with the Spirit if we're full of ourselves. That's individually and nationally. Did I say that? Oh, help me, Jesus. God doesn't want to just fill us. He wants to stretch us. Hallelujah. And when He stretches us, we will never return to the original shape. John Wesley made this statement. Give me 100 preachers who fear nothing but sin and desire nothing but God, and we will shake the gates of hell. Hallelujah. Musicians will come. I want you to stand with me right now. There's a challenge. A challenge. The gauntlet has been thrown. Who will accept the challenge? I said, who will accept that challenge? And say, I will be the one. I am willing. I am willing. That's why I appreciate our missionaries so much. I know there's things we don't understand, and I sure made my mistakes when I was a missionary here. But I do know one thing, they give everything. They give it all. But I also know Filipinos, they give everything. They give it all. Sing it with me. I think we need to reflect on a challenge. Is there an ethnic group near to me that does not have the gospel? Is there somebody? Say, I'll go to the Chinese, even in my own country. Somebody that says, I'll go to the next barangay. I'm not willing for the enemy to be enthroned in my island.
Away. So
Son of God. That there is something worth dying for.